this example, we're going to look at the use of the Peng-Robinson equation of state in a conceptual way to look at what kind of information it can yield and think a little bit physically about what you're actually doing when you calculate a Peng-Robinson isotherm. So here we're told that we're at some temperature and pressure that aren't directly specified. And we basically have calculated what the density is using the temperature and pressure for this cubic equation of state. Right, so remember, equations of state are typically in terms of pressure, temperature, and either volume or density. And in this case, we're working in terms of density rather than volume. And so if we specify a certain temperature and pressure, we can calculate the density. And we often will plot this on a P versus density diagram for different isotherms, and I'll show that in just a minute. But to get back to the problem statement, we're told that we find three roots for the density, so three possible solutions to our cubic equation. And we're designating those rho high, rho mid, and rho low. And it's determined that the cyclohexane exists in the vapor phase. This would be done by computing the fugacities associated with each root, and this indicates that the vapor phase would have the lowest fugacity. All right, but that's a subject we'll go into more detail into at another time. So part one of the question is, if the pressure is increased at constant temperature, will the system eventually achieve vapor-liquid equilibrium? Okay, the answer to that is yes. All right, and we'll see why quickly here by analyzing what's happening in our system. All right, so I've pre-sketched a little pressure versus density diagram. If we have three roots, then we know we're at a place where there's an inflection in our isotherm, as is shown on this plot. All right, so the temperature will go through this sort of rotated S shape. What this means is that if we've specified that temperature, so I've drawn an isotherm, and we've specified a certain pressure, right, then we can draw this constant pressure line, and we see that we have three intersections at different density values. Right, and those, we're told, are rho low, rho mid, and, sorry about that, rho high. And we're furthermore told that we're in the vapor phase. Right, and so if we're in the vapor phase, that's the lowest density phase. And if you remember, on either side of the phase envelope, right, we'll have a vapor region with lower density and a liquid region with higher density. And this middle root is not a stable root that's observed with either of those phases. And so this is where we are at the beginning of the process, where we're at the specified pressure and temperature. We're at a low density. We can see that if we keep on moving up, so the question asks, if we keep increasing the pressure at constant temperature, so we're going to be moving that line upwards, that eventually, let's look at the case where we move the pressure way up, eventually we're going to be in the liquid phase, right? Because the only point of intersection will be with the liquid. And so if we're currently in the vapor phase, and we know by increasing the pressure we can get to the liquid phase, that means that some pressure will be at vapor-liquid equilibrium. And so by increasing the pressure, we can achieve that vapor-liquid equilibrium, and that will occur when the fugacity is equal between the vapor and the liquid phases. Okay, and so the answer to part one is yes, that if we increase the pressure, that we can achieve vapor-liquid equilibrium, right, for the reason that we know there has to be a phase transition. Okay, now in part two, it says, if yes, will the density of the liquid be higher, lower, or equal to rho high? So now we know we're at vapor-liquid equilibrium. All right, and so at vapor-liquid equilibrium, we want to know if the density of the liquid phase is going to be greater than rho high. All right, so we know that we need to get to higher pressure to achieve vapor-liquid equilibrium, as we just discussed in part one of the problem. Right, let's assume that we achieve the equal fugacities between the vapor and liquid phases at this pressure. Right, that doesn't show up as quite horizontal, but that's what I intended to be. Now we know that at this equilibrium, whatever this higher pressure is that I've drawn arbitrarily here, I just know it's above the black line, right, that the vapor phase density will be here, and the liquid phase density will be here. And both the vapor phase roots and the liquid phase roots are at higher density when you increase the pressure. All right, and so therefore, the density of the liquid phase, based on the problem statement, is greater than this high density route that we originally started at, because we have to go to higher pressure and because of the shape of the isotherm.